Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and especially Betsy. It takes a lot to come up here and do your first speech, no matter how confident we think we are. It's very nerve-wracking. And I think Betsy did a great job tonight, and I'd like to talk about some of the areas that she's great at, some of her strengths, and then give her some feedback on some of the areas that she can improve in. So I thought, I loved the way she opened it. She had a very clear opening, body and conclusion for her speech. When she spoke about her opening, she set it up telling us that she was going to speak about strangers. She moved on into the body of her speech where she used the pictures, the stories about the book from her book, and then she said, I have a final story to tell you. So it's very clear. I felt I knew where I was going along with that structure. And then she actually went into a proper conclusion. And to see somebody do that in their icebreaker is quite an achievement. It's quite challenging. So that's great to see that. One of the things she did do, though, did you notice she stumbled early on as she lost her train of thought? And that kind of panic, it was difficult. And isn't it awkward watching someone? You just want to reach out and go, it's okay, it's okay. I did exactly the same thing in my icebreaker. I totally forgot my conclusion. The great thing that Betsy did was she just composed herself. She got her thoughts together and she got back on track. Don't apologise when you mess up like that. People expect you. You know, they expect things to go wrong. It doesn't matter. But don't apologise and make that apology. It's not needed. And it loses your power when you're up here speaking. Her use of language, I'm jealous of her use of language. I wrote down some of her words. She used words like enraptured, debilitated, and she used the word of the day twice. She did all that in her icebreaker, incredible. Good job, well done, Betsy. She has a really soft, easy listening voice. It's very easy to listen to her voice. And I really enjoyed it. In terms of some improvements for her, she had too much content. Her speech was supposed to be 4 to 6 minutes. She went on to 7 minutes 14. What you have to remember is you have to respect the time, because if you're on a tight agenda and you're in a conference or you're speaking at a meeting, you're eating into other people's time. So get that content, Betsy, and cut it down. She used the technology. I felt her transition into the technology and out of it was awkward. It was, and also one of the things, you classic, talking to the pictures, talking to the screen. You want to be able to talk to the audience with your pictures up there. I loved those pictures, by the way. I wanted to know all the stories about every picture. They were amazing. The last thing is she has a nervous twitch with her hair, and ladies with long hair, a lot of us have it. You have to get rid of it with that hair. It's very distracting. I used to do it as well when I had long hair. And the last thing I'd like her to do is slow down and smile. She has a beautiful smile. I don't want to see that smile when she speaks. So I look forward to seeing much more speeches for you in the future, Betsy. And well done. Great job for an icebreaker. Mr. Toastmaster.
Next in line is TJ's father, Rachel Stewart.
Thank you, Toastmasters. So another CC1. TJ gave a really great first speech. What I loved about what he did was the content, the details of the content. I love the content that he provided us with. It painted a picture. One of the most important things that we need to do when we're speaking is to transfer an image in our mind into the minds of the people in the audience, the people we're speaking to. And what TJ was able to do with some, for me, slightly graphic detail about his brother's broken teeth and being fixed, and the hospital patients, the woman with the broken jaw, and the way that the jaw was moving when he put his fingers in. Ooh, for me, that was so vivid. I was there and I was uncomfortable. So that's how great the detail was. And it's the content that's really important. What are we sharing And he shared some beautiful stories. He shared stories that were important to him that had a theme. And this is about the structure. It moves into the structure there. He guided us along this storyline with the theme of decisions that he made, of points that he made. And I think we could see from early on where this was going to go. Decisions that made when he saw his brother's teeth being fixed. And we knew something was going to happen, but it was intriguing. It was interesting. It got our attention very quickly. We weren't quite sure what was going to happen, but there was a story to this. And the storytelling is so important. So those details set it up. Having a structured theme carries us along. And those images that you drop into people's minds keep us connected. Now, the third part that I like to talk about is the delivery. How comfortable was TJ up here? I thought he was comfortable. Yeah. I thought from the fact that he opened with humor that allowed us to laugh. I mean, sometimes people will give humor, you'll tell it's humor, but we don't laugh. TJ has a really nice manner up here. He's got a nice, melodious voice as well. But opening with humor, some other self-deprecating moments of humor as well, kept us engaged. And that's the importance of it. How do we engage the audience? How do we keep the audience with us, take us along for the journey? He did that so well. What convinced me about his comfort up here, his comfort level up here, was that he was able to get the word of the day. He was not nervous, so nervous that he didn't forget that, or that it came to his mind when he was doing it, which is great. Also had a really nice conclusion about the best decision that he ever made. We love to hear how great it is to be part of Toastmasters. So two things. One is storytelling is so important in speeches, which he did so well. And the other thing is connecting with the audience. Now, there were times when TJ was kind of looking at the floor a little bit to remind himself what he was going to say or thinking to the floor. And it's always good to keep our face up, keep our head up, keep the connection with the audience, be looking as much as you can. So sometimes the best tip is to pause and take the time, take a breath to look at the audience rather than looking at the floor. So that'd be one thing to think about going forward. But I think, you know, as we know, coming up here for the first speech, it can be nerve-wracking, and it is also game-changing. Ooh. First one done. TJ did a really nice first speech, so congratulations, TJ, on a really good job.
Cool. Third evaluation of the night. Okay, so could you give us your evaluation for judges?
Great speech. It was a speech that gave us a clear message to take away, and a speech that was clearly built to show Giles' use of structure. I want to talk about two major things right now. I'll talk about how it was delivered, and then focus really on the main objective of the structure of the speech. We start off with a very clear opening. Tonight I am going to talk about how to not make decisions. You say what you're going to talk about. It's a great way to start. The problem is, if you follow it up then, the second opening. Tonight I'm going to talk about Gibraltar. Now, alone, you get a strong impact. You go, ha, I'm not looking for. When you follow it the second time, you go, but I fought. And even though there's clearly a link between them, logically, and how it feels emotionally, it's not always the same thing. So perhaps beware, a double opening can turn a good opening into an okay opening. The way it was done as a speech, we had some great adjectives. I think the use of the language was really descriptive at times. I thought I had some wonderful use of words, which was really giving us this picture of what we're trying to describe. We have this stunningly impractical culture. And this wonderful image we have of both the beauty and the question as to why. We had a shambolic way of doing things at times. And again, these are words which I'm not even sure if they're in the language. We all know what it means, of course. And I think it is perfectly allowed to express yourself as long as we're all linking along. And my favourite, the one I can't even spell, higgledy-piggledy. A word which I have no idea where it came from. But again, use of a good language like this, it makes the speech come alive for us. One thing to watch out for, though, is ums and ums. I think is a habit which starts to slip in a little bit when you're not sure. always worth catching it early and trying to find some sort of way to remind yourself, stop, pause, take a breath, and the whole thing stays smooth and we keep getting just the good words that way. Now onto the structure, we had some very clear sections of it. So we talked about the culture and history, about the impractical activity of Gibraltar, talked about its military history and how it came out, and more about its impracticality as a place. I went into these stories. Now, we saw these sections, but if you asked us where was the line between them, even I couldn't tell you when I was looking for them, because they linked together so smoothly. There was no linking sentence, it just seemed to just naturally drop into the next one, just gently for us. And this is a really good way of doing transitions. In particular, the stories were powerful. They made us laugh. I think everyone had a good sort of shoulder-shaking chuckle going on here. We were enjoying it. But at the end, Giles did something really important. He wrapped up the story and brought it into why this proves his point. And suddenly, it wasn't just a story to make us laugh. It was a part of the speech and part of the structure. This was done really, really well. Again, we're a very powerful conclusion. And I think if it's going to be one game-changing part of a speech, it is how you bring a conclusion to a speech. He brought back some sort of callback, some sort of reference to every single major part of his speech. He even brought back a joke about the fire, bringing back to his stories. And then, first of all, he gave us a lesson to take away, so that we can actually learn from. Now, the thing about a lesson is it feels final. It feels, okay, that's what sort of, it has a satisfying ending to it. I mean, and we have a sort of reassuring sort of, yeah, that was it. And ending on that place, like it did, made it a really clear and very strong and impacting ending for us. So that was a great decision and really well carried out. All in all, really good speech, some good use of language. Perhaps be careful about some ums and ums, but the structure, the conclusion, really well executed and a very good CC2. So thank you, Giles.
Close the round of evaluations. Would you please welcome Jen?
Due to he gave a speech and with the three main points, GPP, so I'm going to share my thoughts with the GPP. The first is going to be goals. So the objective, the goals of her speech is about doing research with the sources and numbers and figures. And there are three main important points that I love from your speech in terms of the goals. You did it based on the objectives. Firstly, it's about the opening. You ask people questions and everyone really like a shock to move to another direction. When you say like GPP is a British power, then you say, no, it's the other thing, it's personal development. So it's really changed the people thinking and they're curious to hear what's going on later on. So I love that one. And the second is about the topic itself about personal development, that like attack to the people, belief and goals and people. You still remember, right? The G, goals? And B, belief, and P, people, right? Mm-hmm. So another thing I love about your speech is about the structure, clear structure, because you have the GPP and you develop, and you give the examples to make it more evidence and make people easier to follow and to imagine. And beautiful because it's personal example, and also some example that people can easily to relate. For example, Toastmaster and Donald Trump, game changing, everything like really updated and everyone can relate to. And I look back to your previous speeches, some of our evaluators, they mentioned that you can improve on the conclusion and improve on the, body language, standing to different places, and also about the volume. And I think all of the things today you did great, and you have really good volume, and even like a vocal variety, and also you control the stage, and you had so powerful conclusion. Everyone agree with me, right? and then people, and then you're gonna have real GPP. I love that one. So that is the three things that you did beyond the objective. And the objective of our research topic, mainly want us to have more sources and more figures. So I think like you have the sources from the UK with 5 million companies and like failed in 5 years, and you have the figure about maybe the number of days in a year. So I would suggest that we can make it like even like more in that evidence by saying, for example, following the economic like research, this is the number 5 million. So where the research come from, and also Donald Trump, maybe you can say like from a paper, newspaper, maybe the Sun. They said Donald Trump, he believed in himself more than Harrington or something. So it's more evidence. So people think like you think from the other sources, not only your personal opinion. Even this really relevant. And even the part about goals, you can also actually there's some research they said like, how many people they set goals in a year and they fail after 3 months. So it's also a good way to pick up the sources. And when you talk about young people to start their business, you also can pick up some number because they have a lot of statistics talk about that. And when you talk about Toastmaster, probably you can bring like Toastmaster website said that there are like maybe 2,000 or about million Toastmaster in the world and how many people. That is a good one to pick up the number and to make it even more resourceful. So about belief, I think today you make everyone believe in themselves more. Do you agree? Yeah, I believe in myself more. Thank you for that. And about part P, I would like to say it, power. You give everyone the power. And 100% power of themselves. Thank you.
Amazing for the evaluations now. And now I have just realized I didn't tell you about the very exciting thing I had found last weekend in Hyde Park. But it's very frustrating to show it off now because of course I've heard so many really interesting new things you found this year. And here I was going to show off an edible chestnut. But I really like these kind of small things. And speaking of small things. Do you know how much trouble I went through to actually find one that was not moldy? It was very late in the chestnut season. Anyway, speaking of small, enjoyable things, after the break we are going to have a set of short impromptu speeches, which are called the table topics. The person in charge of those will be Ryan at the back. So let's have a break. Let's say we are overrunning a bit. Let's be back here at 9. And if you would like to participate, please let Ryan know and we'll see what you can do. That's it. Back at 9.
Nice and bright.
I think it's a major one to be in the original. I think it's a major one to be in the original.